Good morning, everybody. This is another colloquium organized by the Instituto de Astrofísica de Andalucía. And today we will have the talk by Dr. Itziar de Gregorio Monsalvo from the European Southern Observatory in Chile. And she will talk about the searching for the formation mechanism or of Brown Dwarf. Itziar will be properly introduced by Dr. Isabel Márquez. Please, Isabel.
Hello, good morning, everybody. Thank you very much for being here again for another Severo Ochoa weblogium at the IAA. And thank you very much for being here. And thank you very much, our speaker today, for having accepted our invitation. That I take profit to extend to an in-person one in a, we hope, the near future. The nearest the future will be, the better, I mean, the best for all of us. It will mean many things. So thank you very much for all of you for being here. Itziar de Gregorio Monsalvo is the head of the ESO Office for Science, so the Director for Science at the ESO at the European Southern Observatory, and faculty member, faculty chair in Chile. She defended her PhD at the Universidad Autónoma de Madrid in 2006, a thesis that she did in the Spanish National Institute for Aerospace Technology under the supervision of Dr. José Francisco Gómez Rivero, our colleague here at the IAA. The thesis entitled, excuse me, Radioastronomical Study of the Physical Conditions, Kinematics and Chemistry of the Environment Surrounding Low-Mass Young Stellar Objects, was made using the NASA Deep Space Network antennas to set up radio astronomy observations and perform star formation studies at centimeter wavelengths. The same year, in 2006, she joined the European Southern Observatory as the first ESO ALMA fellow, with the duties of the APEX telescope, the Atacama test facility in Socorro, near New Mexico, and the operations support facilities near San Pedro de Atacama. In 2010, she became an ESO faculty member working at the Joint ALMA Observatory as a science operation astronomer. In 2014, she became the head of the ALMA Program Management Group. And in 2018, she became the head of the ESO Offices for Science, so the post that she has today. Her main research activities are focused on star and planetary formation, in particular in the star planets and brown dwarfs formation, in protoplanetary disk formation and evolution, jets and molecular outflows, astrophysical masers, centimeter, millimeter, and submillimeter astronomy, and also interferometry and single dish techniques. Today, she will talk about searching for the formation mechanisms of brown dwarfs. So thank you very much again, Itziar, and welcome to the IAA.
Thank you very much for the introduction. Today I'm going to talk about all the effort my collaborators and myself have been doing in shedding some light on the formation mechanisms of brown dwarfs. You can see some of the main collaborators there. I didn't include many of them, okay? Just a second. Okay, so this is the outline of this talk. I will start with a general introduction on how brown dwarfs form. Then I will comment on the observational strategies that we follow to try to study this formation. I will present some observational results from our work, and I will end up with the conclusions as usual. Brown dwarfs are very low mass objects, are very faint. They would be in this side of the HR diagram. They do not have enough mass to sustain hydrogen burning nuclear fusion in their core, as main sequence stars usually do. But on the other side, its core temperature is high enough to initiate the fusion of deuterium. So this is going to give us the range of masses where we can find these brown dwarfs. We are talking about objects between 13 Jupiter masses and 80 Jupiter masses. Below that limit, we would be talking about planetary mass objects. The brown dwarfs were discovered in 1995, observationally. And here you can see a picture where you can see the comparison between our sun, okay, and Jupiter, like planets. So the brown dwarfs would be in this range. We are dealing here with, as I said, with cold objects. This is the first brown dwarf detected, Theta 1, right? And later it was detected more all round, older brown dwarfs, colder objects, like Lise 2029b, right? Which is the companion of this other red dwarf, very low mass star, right? And then recently we started to discover these very cold brown dwarfs or free floating planets, right? Like WISE-1828, and they share a lot of similarity with Jupiter-like planets. And these, okay, you can see here, they are very cold objects, like 300 Kelvin. This object in particular is in the close neighbor. Okay, and well, they have atmosphere similar to Jupiter. For example, they show methane, water, but lacks phosphine, very likely because of the sensitivity of the observation. And we need to wait for telescope like the James Webb or the ELT for a deeper characterization of these objects. But because of these similarities with Jupiter-like planets, there is now a debate about the classification of brown dwarfs in terms of their formation processes, instead of by the mass limit. In this classification, brown dwarfs would be the lowest mass product of the star formation process, and the free floating planets would be objects formed in a different way, for example, in an accretion disk surrounding a star. So these formation mechanisms theories impact also in the brown dwarf or planet classification. Another interesting things about brown dwarfs is that they can host planets. The first image of an exoplanet in 2004 was discovered surrounding a brown dwarf. We are talking about a 5 Jupiter masses planet. And later, using the gravitational microlensing technique, it was discovered a super Earth, like 3 Earth masses, surrounding also a brown dwarf. So the question here is, may brown dwarf form rocky planets? So our team tried to shed some lights into this question, as for ALMA cycle zero observations to study the disk surrounding a brown dwarf in Rho Fucus, which is a relatively high mass brown dwarf, okay, but still in the region of brown dwarfs. So we perform observations between 890 microns and 3.2 millimeters. To try to detect the dust and also the molecular content through the CO molecule. We have positive detections of the dust and of the gas, right? And when we studied the spectral index, it was compatible with the existence of millimeter size grains in the disk outer regions. So we were witnessing the grain growth even in this low dense environments, right? Moreover, the disk masses that we saw was a few Jupiter masses, and theoretical models said that this surrounding these very low mass objects, substellar objects, if they contain a few Jupiter masses, they have the potential to form rocky planets. So with this work, we demonstrate that the probability for finding Earth-like planets increase if we consider also this object, which is very interesting. Very recently, in the same line of studies, it was published a transition disk around a brown dwarf, an object in the limit between brown dwarf and very low mass stars of 80 Jupiter masses in this region, okay, in Ophiuchus again. It is a companion from other low mass object. And here you can see a structure that suggests the presence of a hole inside. A few days ago, there was another work at a higher resolution and higher sensitivity about the discovery of a bright inner disk in the transition disk around a very low mass star in Theta 1. And here you can see the presence of a cavity and an inner ring. And one of the possibilities for the explanation of this structure is that we are having there a super Earth in the very inner part of the disk. So we are witnessing also the very likely the formation of planets inside the disk of these objects. In relation to this very low mass star, which are the link between brown dwarfs and stars, they are very interesting also to study because, well, they are the smallest and coolest stars of the main sequence and the most common star in our galaxy. And we know that some of them contain planetary systems like TRAPPIST-1, which is a 7 rocky planet systems, and 3 of them have Earth size and likely are in the habitable zone. So, well, because of that, the studies of planetary formation in this very low mass star is super interesting. So let's go now to the formation mechanisms of substellar objects. There are a few main theories about how this object may form. The first one is like low mass stars, okay, through cloud fragmentation and gravitational collapse. The other possibility is that these objects are aborted stellar embryos. So we have here two scenarios. The first one is the ejection scenario, where these objects are part of a cluster of stars, and through dynamical processes in this stellar cluster, some of the less massive objects are ejected. The second scenario inside this aborted stellar embryos possibility is through photo-evaporation of a stellar mass core in the presence of high mass star. So basically the radiation coming from this high mass star is going to swap all the material or most of the material from the envelope of this stellar mass object, and it will end up in a substellar object. And the last possibility is that these objects may be formed inside circumstellar disk, like planets, right? So because of tidal interaction between different components of the system, at some point these fragments and some of these objects that are being formed inside may be ejected from the system, okay? So all these formation mechanisms predict the disk, the existence of disk around brown dwarf, right? So if we study the properties of the disk surrounding class two brown dwarfs, we may discriminate different formation mechanisms, because all of these theories predict different size and masses of the disk. For example, in the disk fragmentation scenario, the model predicts larger disk masses because they accrete gas from the parent star during disk during the first years after they form. And because of tidal truncation in this star or this dynamical interaction, the expected radius from these disks are small. And on the other side, the ejection scenario predicts also very small disks, and it is expected that 50% of them has a radius smaller than 10 AUs, okay? So if we want to study the disk masses and the disk sizes to discriminate different formation mechanisms, we need a telescope like ALMA with enough spatial resolution and sensitivity. Okay, so in this line, since the very beginning of the ALMA operation, since cycle zero, sorry, we try to observe the brightest submillimeter disk in brown dwarfs and very low mass stars in Taurus, right? So it was biased at that time for this brightest disk because of the sensitivity capabilities of a limited array in cycle zero, right? So in this case, we detected dust emission from all the sources, right? And we could resolve the disk, and all of them show large disk between 70 and 140 AUs. So it supports the stellar like a scenario. We didn't see any truncation in this disk. And they were relatively high massive disks for these objects of a few Jupiter masses. And we also saw the presence of grain growth. So they have potential to form rocky planets. So in this case, we were seeing a stellar like a scenario formation of brown dwarfs, right? Then a few years later, with ALMA more extended capabilities, what we did was to do a survey in Rho Fiucus star forming regions. It was a large and homogeneous sample of spectrally confirmed brown dwarfs with excess of infrared emission. So in this case, it was not unbiased, it was unbiased to the brightest disk. We have 17 sources and we detected compact dusty disk in 11 of them with tiny radius, smaller than 20 AUs. Also, the relation between the mass of the disk and the mass of the star was smaller than the one seen in T Tauris. And this was indicative of that there was an environmental effect, very likely because of close encounters with other companions or other objects around. And this is likely pointing to to a dynamical truncation of brown dwarf disk in this specific region, right? Moreover, the mass of the disk was smaller in comparison with the disk we saw in Taurus. And in this case, the planet formation would be difficult to happen or impossible to happen there unless the planets are already formed inside. So, these observations can provide information about this formation mechanism, but the problem is that this evolution may transform the initial properties of the disks, because we know green growth may happen and the formation of planets inside the disk may also happen there, right? So since the signatures of formation evolve with time, it's better to observe these objects when they are even younger, right? So what we tried to do in the next studies was to try to detect substellar objects surrounded by cold dusty envelopes by outflows this system as a scaled down version of low mass stars, basically. And this would provide direct support for in situ star formation as low mass stars do, right? So just to mention that all the mechanisms can form substellar objects, but here we wanted to know which one was the most efficient one. And of course, we needed observations at very high resolution and sensitivity in the millimeter and submillimeter region to discriminate between these different scenarios. So following this motivation, we thought about two different types of strategies. The first one was called multi-wavelength surveys. Basically, we use multi-wavelength data, mainly from the infrared to the optical, to build infrared color diagrams and spectral energy distributions to identify young brown dwarfs candidates. Then we proceed with a subsequent characterization in the submillimeter regime, first of all at low and then at high angular resolution. And well, this technique is good for identification of proto-brown dwarfs, right? But since it requires the detection of a central object in the infrared, it is not good for identifying substellar objects in the earliest stages, in the pre-brown dwarf stage, right? The second strategy that we call high sensitivity submillimeter maps started with large scale maps of young star forming regions in the millimeter submillimeter to identify cold clumps that are in the substellar regime. Then we use multi-wavelength data to build the spectral energy distribution and to characterize these objects. So this method is good to detect very young substellar candidates in the pre-brown dwarf phase. So I'm going to show you the results of some of our studies. We focus into different star forming regions, Taurus, Chameleon 2, Barnard 2, and Lupus 1 and 3, with different approaches. So we first of all try the multi-wavelength survey strategy in Taurus. Basically, we analyze IRAC Spitzer data. We produce color diagrams to study the jump population here. Then color magnitude diagrams, including evolutionary tracks. And among all the class 0 and 1 candidates detected, we selected those with magnitudes consistent with substellar nature. Okay, this is the region where we performed the studies. And at the end, we could isolate 12 candidates to be young proto-brown dwarfs in class 0-1 stage in a couple of clouds of Taurus, B213 and L1495. And this is a very short summary of all the work we did there with different telescopes. So first of all, we built the spectral energy distribution using archival data and new multi-wavelength observations from 0.8 microns to 6 centimeters, okay? And then we perform these observations in the millimeter and centimeter regime. We use CO at 350 microns, iron 30 meter at 1.2 millimeter in continual spectral line, Robledo 70 meter in a spectral line, and BLA in continuum from 3 to 6 centimeters to try to see free emission from these objects. So in this plot, in this image, I have represented in the background in yellow the CO, the spire map at 250 microns. And then in blue contours, you can see the CSO 350 micron observation. So basically we were detecting a cold envelope surrounding one of the of our candidates, which is there, right? And close to it, another clump of very cold dust. When we perform iron 30 meter observations, we saw the presence of faint molecular outflow in this direction also. And I didn't show it, but we also detected other high density gas tracers associated to this other clump, right? And then when we observed with the VLA, we detected free emission, okay? Studying the spectral index between 6 and 3.6 centimeter and in, elongated in this direction, right? So we studied the spectral energy distribution of these objects, and at the end, we concluded that the most compact object is a very good candidate to be a proto-Brown dwarf. It showed an extended envelope of 2000 AUs and a mass of 5 Jupiter masses and the presence of a radiojet. And the other clump that was located into the northeast was a candidate to be a pre-Brown dwarf. It showed a extended envelope, also a relatively low mass envelope of 100 Jupiter masses. And when we studied N2H+, it showed similar gravitational mass. Okay, so we concluded it was a starless, and that's the reason why we think it's a pre-Brown dwarf in this case. Okay. Of course, this this was followed up by ALMA, but we are still in the process of analyzing the data. But so far, they are showing very promising results of gas surrounding this proto Brown dwarf. Another study we did in Tauro was with the VLA in the rest of the candidates of the sample to search thermal radio jets at centimeter wavelengths. Right, basically. This is marking free radiation from ionized gas, but the shock of a stellar wind with the surrounding medium, which is expected in class zero, class one objects. And as a result, we had the first tentative detection of 4 thermal radio jets in class one proto-Brown dwarf candidates. Some of them resolved. Okay. So this multi-wavelength survey strategy was good then to detect proto-Brown dwarfs, class 0 to 1 sources, right? Well, we detected by chance a pre-Brown dwarf, but it was not an original target from this strategy. But the problem, as I said before, is that the candidates selected based on infrared catalogs, which contain central objects or infrared counterparts, right? So this is not good for the identification of pre-Brown dwarfs because we don't expect even the presence of infrared sources there. And we move to the next studies, we move to the other strategy to observe high sensitivity submillimeter maps. And this time I'm going to present the works we did in Chameleon 2. So first of all, we use IRAC, Spitzer color diagrams, to classify the Chameleon 2 members, right? We selected a region of 14 by 14 arc minutes, which is this one, where the highest density of low mass class one and class one to two objects is observed. So we selected the place of the cloud with most recent star formation, and we did a deep continuum observations with the La Boca Olometer Array at the Apex Telescope in Chagnantor, where ALMA is. So with the aim of detecting faint cold dust emission, right? And we perform very deep observations to make sure we were detecting objects into the substellar region. Here you can see a very nice picture from Herschel, right, on Chameleon 2. And this is the area we mapped with the laboratory array. And these are the results of our map, okay? We detected 15 cores at a signal to noise higher than 5. 11 of these 15 cores were substellar with masses ranging from 16 to 66 Jupiter masses. And some of them presented also extended structure. So this is a close-up image of all the compact detection we had. And we overlay the PACS map in the background in color and to confirm that these faint objects were also detected at other wavelengths. And as you can see, they were, right? And well, the next step was to study the nature of all these objects. And for that, we cross-match the position of the peak of these clumps with a multi-wavelength catalog from the optical to the far infrared. And we built also the set to identify reliable young stellar objects or proto-Brown dwarfs candidates. We also use Robitaille set models to identify background stars and young stellar objects. This is an example of this identification work, an association to contour pairs, right? In the case of this object, we have contour pairs that are really close to the peak of the clump, observing La Boca with this shape, right? And then we have a bunch of other contour pairs nearby, not so close, but nearby, which are here, right? And well, they don't make too much sense in terms of tracing young stellar objects. In this other case, this is the only source nearby the peak of this other clump, which saw no star associated to that. It was a starless core, and very likely this was a background star. So the main result of this work was, first of all, the identification of a proto-Brown dwarf candidate here, right? With counterpart at 3.6 and 4.5 micron. When we represent the spectral energy distribution in black here, and we compare with other proto-Brown dwarf candidates that were detected by our team, they looks like very similar. And we extracted a luminosity of 0.0 solar luminosities, right? Which is very low luminosity object, and a mass envelope of 50 Jupiter masses in the substellar region. The second result, to me, is the most interesting because it deals with clumps with no counterparts, with what we would call pre-Brown dwarfs. So for studying its nature, we follow the theory of the turbulent fragmentation by Padwan and Nordlund that predicts in-situ formation of Brown dwarfs, right? So they claim that cores of any size can be formed if the density of the core is higher than a critical density that can be inferred from the mass of the critical bonor effer isothermal sphere. So basically, we could test the density in the spatially resolved starless clumps, okay? For the ones that were resolved, we saw that the density of the core was smaller than the critical one, so most of them are not collapsing, so they are very likely transient clumps. But then we have a number of them that were not resolved spatially, were point-like sources in lab observations. And what we did is to extract information to infer the minimum radius they should have for reaching the critical density, right? And at the end, they could we conclude that they could become pre-substellar objects if they have sizes between 200 and 1,000 AUs, which is near 1 arc second at the distance of Chameleon 2, depending on their masses. And of course, this could be resolved with ALMA. So the next step should be observe these objects with ALMA. But before, we did in parallel similar studies in another region, Barnard 30, which is in Lambda Orionis region, okay? This is very interesting because Lambda Orionis is a high mass star, so we wanted also to test the effects of having a high mass star nearby, right? And we use the same technique that for Chameleon 2, and this is the outcome of the observations with Lavoca. We detected plenty, of course, 34 submillimeter cores, very low in mass, between 0.4 and 0.04 and 0.1 solar masses. Okay, and for this, we did an ALMA follow-up observations in continuum at 870 micron and in line in CO322, and at 1 arc second resolution, more or less. So we could observe 30 positions, and we detect compact emission in 5 of them with continuum detections, by the way. And the first thing to mention is that it's related to the detection rate. It was a low detection rate, okay? We were expecting to detect more. So we did a study of the flux that we were missing based on the few detection we have, and we are losing more than 85% of the flux there. We designed this experiment considering that all the mass of the clamp would be, in the worst case scenario, distributed in the largest angular scale of these ALMA observations, right? So we requested some sensitivity enough to detect these objects in this worst case scenario, right? So we don't think it is related to the sensitivity of the observation, but we think it is related with the distribution of most of the mass of these clamps from La Boca in large scale, spatial scales, right? So maybe this is pointing to the fact that we need to do a follow-up observation using the compact array to see what's going on in the intermediate sizes scales, spatial scales there, right? And another thing, interesting thing to comment is that we didn't see any spatial correlation with the position, with respect to the position of this high mass star, Lambda Orionis. Now, we study the nature of the detections using, again, archival multi-wavelength data and the sets information. So we conclude that from these 5 detections, 2 have a stellar nature. One is a class 1 and the other one is a class 2. Actually, we detected the presence of CO322 gas, okay? And it's tracing an envelope and a disk, respectively. And for the remaining 3 objects with no counterpart inside, we extracted a mass of 10 Jupiter masses, no infrared counterparts, and no gas detection, okay? So we had here 2 possibilities for explaining the nature of these objects. One is that they are deeply embedded proto-Brown Dwarfs objects. So using the upper limits from the spectral energy distribution, we tried to characterize a bit these objects. 2 of them show very low volumetric luminosity and also low volumetric temperature, right? So we think we are dealing here with very low luminosity objects, class 0 or more evolved, right, in both cases. And for the case of LV10, we have no data to do any conclusion there. The second possibility is that they have pre-Brown Dwarf nature, right? So if we consider that, well, these objects are inside these bigger clamps from La Boca, right? If we consider these cores from La Boca may collapse to form a star with a core formation efficiency of 30%, if we add this 30% to the mass of these compact ALMA sources, they would still be in the substellar regime. So we think if they have pre-Brown Dwarf nature, we are dealing with real pre-Brown Dwarf cores. So in order to characterize a bit more the possible substellar nature of these 3 objects, we did the same calculations of critical density and critical radius. None of them are resolved spatially. So we have a maximum radius that is provided by the size of the synthesizer beam, right? And we infer a critical radius of between 2 and 82 AUs needed to reach density higher than the critical density and consistent with thin falling objects, right? On the other side, we did the same calculations for the bigger lavocal clumps, and we were expecting to have, as a result, these clumps contracting, right? But we didn't see that. We saw that the density of these cores were smaller than the critical density, right? So they were gravitationally stable objects, likely transient clumps. But on the other side, we observed compact sources at the center of these lavocal clumps, which is indicative of ongoing collapse. So here we did a test. We assume R to the minus two density profile in these lavocal clumps, which is characteristic of a collapsing core. And we estimated the masses inside one ALMA beam, right? And what we obtained was consistent with the observed masses inferred from the ALMA observations. So we propose these cores observed with ALMA are the result of a large scale gravitational contraction constituted the tip of the iceberg of a larger scale collapse. And this is the last region that we study. It's a search for proto-Brown dwarfs in lupus 1 and in lupus 3, right? So in this case, we had a broader scope. We characterized all the substellar population at different evolutionary stages. Well, lupus is an archetypal star-forming region in the southern hemisphere. It is relatively close and it can play a similar role than Taurus in the ALMA era. And we, as part of a very, very big collaboration called SOLA, Soul of Lupus with ALMA, we got continuum maps at 1 millimeter observed with the Aztec bolometer array in the Aztec telescope, also in Chagnantor. And we got these nice maps in lupus 1 and lupus 3 where we could extract these very cold clumps, right? We also use multi-wavelength archival data from the optical to the submillimeter to study the nature of these clumps. And as a result, we obtain a sample of 33 pre-Brown dwarfs, class 6, class and 0 candidates of substellar nature of all of them. And on top of that, we use 22 class 2 and 3 class 1 to 2 substellar objects from the literature, okay? And we observe then with ALMA in band 6 in continuum at 1.3 millimeter and in CO221 at a resolution also of approximately 1 arc second. So here I have represented a Herschel map in lupus 1 and lupus 2, and I included here most of the detections we had with these ALMA observations. We obtained 19 detections with masses between 0.2 and 124 Jupiter masses. 5 of them belongs to class 0 objects and none of them are resolved. We detected 2 new class 0 to 1 proto-Brown dwarf candidates and 12 objects with no counterparts are good candidates for being pre-Brown dwarfs or deeply embedded protostellar candidates. Here I have represented a plot of volumetric luminosity versus volumetric temperature, and it contains plenty of objects from the literature in the stellar regime, also some very low luminosity objects and first hydrostatic cores. Our sources are these red points. Okay, so with this deep ALMA observation, we are dealing with the least luminous young stellar substellar candidates so far. Let me show you some of these main results. The first one is the detection of a class 0-1 proto-Brown dwarf candidate, okay? This is the ALMA observations at, that I have presented before. So we infer an envelope, a mass envelope of 4 Jupiter masses and a radius of 50 AUs. The infrared slope is compatible with a class 1 and the volumetric temperature compatible with a class 2. So this is the reason why we think we are dealing with a class 0, between class 0 and 1 object. And the spectral energy distribution in these black points is similar to other proto-Brown dwarf candidates we detected in Taurus, right? In red and in blue. if we add the 30% of the mass of the Aztec clumps, it is still remaining in the substellar regime. Okay, so we think that at the end it could form a brown dwarf. And in relation to the pre-substellar candidates, we repeat the studies that we did in the other region following the theory of turbulent fragmentation. There was one spatially resolved starless pre-brown dwarf candidate. And there we confirmed that it was gravitationally unstable, but for the rest of the sources, we couldn't resolve it spatially, and they are point-like ALMA sources. And they could grow in mass and become pre-substellar objects if they have radius between 13 to 80 AUs, depending on their mass. Our observations didn't reach this angular resolution, so we need extra ALMA observations to test these results. On the other side, the Aztec clumps, the big clumps where this compact emission is inside, are stable, as we saw in other regions, right? But there is a compact source in size, as we are seeing with ALMA. So repeating the same exercise than in other regions, we consider R to the minus two density profile and the expected mass inside an ALMA is coming from this mass of the Aztec core is consistent with the mass inferred from the ALMA observation. So again, we think the proto-brown dwarf cores might be the byproduct of an ongoing process of large scale collapse, okay? And again, if we add this 30% of mass from these bigger clumps, from the Aztec clumps, the final object would still remain in the substellar regime. So if they are pre-brown dwarfs, they would end up in creating brown dwarfs. And just a few words about the sample of class two substellar sources that we observed in Lupus. Well, in this case, we computed the dust, these masses of the class sources in Lupus in our sample, along with previous class two brown dwarfs and very low mass observed with ALMA in other regions. And also we included objects observed in the stellar regime in Lupus, right? So what you can see here is a plot of the mass of the dust versus the mass of the central object. This gray area are the prediction for the disfragmentation, okay? And this other area, green and blue, are the predictions from the stellar regime, okay? Here we will have the brown dwarfs. At the other side, we will have the stars, right? And as a result, the class two brown dwarf disks follow the correlation of mass of the dust versus mass of the star of observed at the low mass stellar regime, right? Which is this. So this could be indicative that they are a scaled down version of low mass star formation, okay? And moreover, another result is that 40% of them here are consistent with this fragmentation scenario. So on one side, this is telling us that very likely the scaled down version of low mass star formation as a formation mechanism for substellar objects is the most efficient, but the disfragmentation scenario is producing a non-negligible number of substellar objects. Of course, we need much more observations. And one of these class two objects was Parlo-3-4, and this is the only object where we could detect the base of our molecular outflow. You can see in CO322 contours, the base of this molecular outflow. In green, I have represented the continuum dust emission from this source, which was not spatially resolved. And it is overlaid with an image of an optical jet observed by other authors, right? So we try to measure as much as we could with this data, the outflow properties of this source, and they are in the range observed in other brown dwarfs and very low mass stars, which by the way are very scarce in the literature. This points also that they are a downside version of star formation processes. Also, if we represent in this plot the Windmill loss rate versus the outflow mass, it follows the trend of more massive stellar sources, which are here, right? And our object is there, but the trend seems to be similar, though. This is pointing again to a scaled down version of low mass stars. So what is next? Okay. Well, the detection of this pre-Brown dwarf is extremely difficult, even with ALMA. The proper studies of these objects are super difficult. Actually, there is only one identification of a pre-Brown dwarf by Philippe André, right? It is this object in Ophiuchus region. They could detect a mass envelope, okay, of a few Jupiter masses, and they could also resolve spatially this structure. And they detected gas associated, compact gas associated to this source. And they infer also the dynamical mass, and they concluded it is a self-gravity condensation of gas and dust, right? But this is the only confirmation, identification of a pre-Brown dwarf in the literature. What we have done is to follow up our sources in other ALMA proposals. We got time for Barnard 30 in this case. We designed observation in the band 7 at 1 arc second resolution to study these pre-Brown candidates that we saw in Barnard 30. First of all, to confirm the faint dust detections at other wavelength, in this case at 70 microns. Also to study the spectral index and to try to detect gas associated to these sources, right? In Lupus, we did something similar, but a bit more complete. We applied for band 3 and for band 7, same spatial resolution, 1 arc second, to study all the list of pre and proto Brown dwarf candidates, again, to confirm the detections and to study a spectral index and to try to get gas detections associated to these sources. We are really interested in getting this gas associated to these compact sources because, well, first of all, for doing all type of calculations about dynamical masses and confirm that they are self-gravity structures. And secondly, because there is still a risk that they are submillimeter galaxies. It's a remote possibility, okay? They are in the center of clumps inside molecular clouds, but we need to make sure that they are not background objects, right? So we are still in the process of analyzing this data, but a preliminary inspection of this data shows confirmation of all the detections at different wavelengths, okay? We did a quick study on spectral indexes, and for 60% of them, we saw similar spectral index to the ISM, okay? So this would support in situ formation of substellar objects. For approximately the 40%, we saw spectral indices that are indicative of grain growth. So this would support this fragmentation scenario. And on the other side, the gas detection, which are extremely difficult, are not present in many of the sources. And we only have a few tentative detections that need to be confirmed and well confirmed. And I have shown here one of these detection, which is not compact, by the way, it's more extended surrounding one of the objects. And we also saw H13CO+ in the position of one of our sources. And here you can see integrated emission and a velocity field maps, okay? So conclusions to take away from these studies. Well, a combination of strategies must be applied to study the formation mechanisms of substellar objects. The sizes and the mass of this around young Brown dwarfs help to discriminate between ejection, this fragmentation in situ formation of scenarios. But dust evolution inside disk and planet formation that we know that may happen now may transform those initial values. So signatures of formation evolve with time. So it's better to study them when they are in the earliest phases of their formation. Large and biased surveys in different star forming regions are needed to test different scenarios. And our studies indicate a scaled down version of low mass stars is the most efficient mechanisms. This fragmentation and ejection may be responsible also for a non-negligible number of substellar objects. So this depends on the environment. And then the earliest stages of formation of these substellar objects require extremely good sensitivity and high resolution in the submillimeter to detect this dust and gas called envelopes of flows disk. ALMA, with its carving capabilities, are helping to understand the formation of substellar objects. But on the other side, we need more sensitivity. And at some point, we will need also higher spatial resolution to make real progresses in the field. So fortunately, ALMA sets the development objectives for the next decade. So we are waiting for that to happen, to have these technical requirements. Okay, and very likely in the future, this nice image of different structures inside a different type of protoplanetary disk in the stellar region, maybe a picture in the substellar region. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Itziar, for this wonderful talk. And I now open the talk for questions. Please raise your hand. For doing that, press the button reactions in the menu in the bottom of the of your screen, and then you will find the button raise your hand. Who will be the first one in asking Itziar? Miguel, please go on.
Hi, Itziar. Thank you very much for your talk. Very nice. My question is, well, I have a few questions, but since nobody asked, so first thing is there any way to have a preferred scenario? You mentioned that some of them or all of them might work, but is there any reason to prefer one of them, or could you elaborate more on this?
Yeah, well, no, it depends on the observational results. That's the reason why it's so important to have a lot of observations in different regions. On one side, we see that in some star-forming regions, the ejection scenario is working more efficiently than, for example, in Taurus, right? Where we don't have so much density of objects, right? It's more tenuous medium than Ophiuchus. But on the other side, what we are seeing when we do this submillimeter maps and study without any bias, we study these submillimeter clamps, is that a scaled down version of the formation of stars is at work there, right? So I could say with the few observations we have now, it's more efficient a scaled down version of the star formation, right? But remember also that we are getting a percentage of sources that show truncation, okay, and masses compatible with the disfragmentation scenario. So, well, I would say the preferred scenario is a scaled down version right now, but we don't have enough observations to conclude it.
Okay, thanks. So if I may ask, it's a quick question because it's related actually. So you mentioned now that you need more data, et cetera, but I guess this is one of the motivation or should be one of the main motivations, I guess. I mean, to discern about this scenario. So which is the kind of sample you are working? I mean, is it a very large one? I mean, I'm not sure it's the number, but I'm asking about the numbers. It will be enough 20 objects to really answer that question, 30, 40, I don't know.
As much as we can.
Well, that's not fair to other parts of science. I mean,
in many star-forming regions, I would go for star-forming regions with different environments. Actually, we kind of try that when we move to the Lambda Orionis region, because one of the possibilities for formation of these brown dwarfs, of the substellar objects, is that they start as a stellar object, but in the presence of a high mass star, most of the material of the envelope is swept by the radiation from this star. We didn't see any trend. Maybe we are not enough close to the star, right? So we need to extend our studies in different type of molecular clouds, different conditions, different environments, at least to kind of isolate the environmental effects, right?
Okay, thanks.
If you ask me for a number, I cannot tell you as much as we can.
It's fair enough. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Miguel. We have another question by Guillem or Mayra. Please go on.
This is Mayra. Itziar, thank you very much for this nice talk. I would like to ask about the radius of the protoplanetary disk around dwarfs, brown dwarfs. If I understood well, you say, based on the studies of testing, that the protoplanetary disks around these objects are small, with radius smaller than 25 solar radius, astronomical units, pardon. My question is this candidate are observed at other frequencies, for instance, near infrared, in order to constrain the radius, to confirm the small radius also in this, in other bands, and also in gas. Are there also small in infrared or in gas? This is my question.
Well, in relation to the gas, it's very difficult. We couldn't manage to detect gas around all of them, right? We need deeper observations. And remember, the design of these observations was for doing a survey in a large number of sources, so we cannot ask for in infinite hours at ALMA, right? So I don't know in the case of gases. What we did was to detect gas traced by CO322 in the Taurus, in the tiny sample of Taurus, right? It was biased for the brightest ones. And there we can see the same trend that we see in the stellar regime. This the size of the gaseous disk are bigger than the size of the dusty disk. Okay, in the infrared, I don't have information about the spatial resolution of this disk. Although they may be tracing different dust grain population in the millimeter submillimeter, we are seeing large grains, while in the infrared we are seeing smaller dust grains.
It will be interesting to see if these are also small in scattering line, for instance, with the sphere in the mid infrared, no? Or near infrared. Yeah. It's sure. My point. Thank you.
Hi, this is Guillem. Thank you, Itziar, for the nice talk. It was very clear and everything very well explained. And I have a couple of questions and curiosities. And you say you assume a density profile going as the radius square as minus two. And you say this is because you assume this is in falling matter. And however, in a free infall, the density profile is expected to go to minus 1.5. Minus 2 is more expected for an isothermal static sphere. So does it make a strong difference, this assumption on the results?
We didn't check with that density profile, but we kind of observed that density profile in a few objects in lupus, and we think this may be related also with the different stage of evolution of the objects we are seeing there, right? That maybe this radius to the minus 1.5 develops into a minus 2 with the time. But we didn't check again this calculation, honestly.
Yeah, in fact, in the earliest stages of the collapse, one will expect that the arc to minus 1.5 profile is only in the very small region near the center, and the outer radius will have a minus 2 profile. And the other question is regarding the confusion with background galaxies, because I have considered several examples of free emission associated with proto-brown dwarfs, and actually in a couple of occasions they look actually very like background galaxies, and both they are expected to have similar colors, and also they can look as radio jets in both cases. And you mentioned it that you can discriminate between actual galactic objects and extragalactic with the molecular lines. And however, you have a lot of lines when you observe with ALMA, and a lot of transitions. And also you can also have outflows that will shift also the frequency. Is really factible to differentiate between a galactic object or an extragalactic one if one has many possible transitions and many combinations of velocities? Because, for example, for CO will be very clear, but you mentioned a molecule that was not so usual, at least for me, HCO plus or something like that. I don't know exactly which one was.
Yeah, so in the case of H13CO plus, it was seen to be a good tracer of the gas surrounding pre-stellar cores in the stellar regime, right? We have this very tentative detection that we need, again, to confirm, or we need to work much more on the data, right? And the thing is that it is at the velocity, more or less at the velocity of lupus clouds, okay? And it's compact and centered exactly in the position of the continuum of these pre-Brown Dwarf candidates. If it were an extragalactic object, I would expect some shift in velocity, okay, from this line. And also the fact that this molecular space is tracing dense gas in pre-stellar cores in the stellar regimes make me think that maybe we are seeing this gas associated to these pre-Brown Dwarfs, okay?
Yes, but my question was, if you do not know that it is actually this molecule, imagine, for example, you can have CO, for example, from an extragalactic source that appears at a different frequency, mm-hmm. and it's close to the frequency of HCO plus, and then you identify this CO as HCO plus or any other molecule. I mean, it's because there is a very large number of transitions, and you can play with the velocity and the transition. So how do you associate? Probably you will need several transitions or a transition with a very clear separation in frequency between different levels or so. This was my question.
I understand the question better now. So yeah, first of all, it's a probability thing, right? The probability that you have an emission from a submillimeter galaxy at a redshift that is, you know, exactly shifting a strong molecular line just at the velocity of the lupus cloud is low, right? And on the other side, with these submillimeter galaxies, we would expect the emission from all the galaxy, right? We would expect some line broadening. The width of the line should be wider than the one expected is in this object, which should be thinner, right? Smaller. And also the other tentative detection that was not very compact, but more spread out are surrounding one of our candidates, right? Is N2H plus, which seems to trace also very well the coal dust and the coal dust and dense gas surrounding these pre-stellar objects in the stellar regime. This was the same transition that Philippe André used for the confirmation of the only known so far pre-Brown Dwarf object, right? I don't know if I answered your answer, Guillem, but it's
a matter of very well, very well. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Okay, thank you, Guillem. Thank you, Mayra. Do we have any other question? Okay, seeing none, I will thank again Itziar for this marvelous talk. And of course, as Isabel told you, you are invited to come here. Maybe we can arrange in the next year. Thank you very much for the
time. Thank you to you for the invitation.